Hi, guys. Really, we've got 6 minutes, but I'm going to start it anyway. Have you guys read Thinking Fast and Slow, Peter?
No.
No. We have not, Invincibles. So we feel free. So, guys, let me set some parameters. I still have Facebook Live going on here. How about I scroll out, Peter?
Go for it.
Yep. Yep. Hey, I love the job you did on your webinar. I watched that the other day, the one from November.
Oh, yeah. Thanks. Awesome.
That was good. I like the beginning of it. You're like, this is perfect for me. Trying to run everything. Feel free, you guys. So what we're going to do, let me set some ground rules for us where we have 5 minutes to go. But what we're going to do is we're going to start the recording, which I have. We're going to officially start the show. Or actually, Peter, whenever you're ready.
Yeah, what's your Twitter handle?
What?
Your Twitter handle.
The Mia Connect.
I thought, okay.
Because somebody stole Mia Lawson is sitting on it and doing nothing.
So you can dog shame them. Email Twitter, and if they haven't used it in a few years, they'll give it to you.
Yeah, I'm going to have to email them again. Jenny Q just mentioned this over on Twitter. You guys, go hit the tweet button right now and tell people about this, because more than just the fact that I am wildly crazy about Peter Shankman, and you all know that, he's going to give us some great information that you guys need. Peter, it's really striking a chord with a lot of people, by the way.
Oh.
So you're on the right path, brother, but I think you
need
that.
I'm my best.
So, hey, Shalia Sparks, nice to see you over there. But guys, so what we're going to do, Dawn is here with us as well. She's going to kind of be handling the crew, but Peter and I are going to focus on the conversation. And then Peter, whenever you're ready, we will also, we may have some people jump in and ask some questions. Are you cool for school with that?
Why not?
Yeah. You seem like you can roll with the punches. Invincible Best says, Peter, I saw you after a while and holy smokes, you have lost a lot of weight. You look fit. Congrats.
Thank you. I've been busting my ass. So trying my
best. Have you guys following, Peter, could you pop your handle in here too for Snapchat? Because
I am at Peter Shankman on every single social out there. So at Peter Shankman everywhere.
Shocker. Total shocker, right? Hey guys, could you let us know out there in the audience if you're hearing any echo? Because for right now, because I do still have some live viewers. I'm going to leave this on here. You know what, Peter, do you know Jim Long?
Yeah.
New Media Jim. Hi, Jim Long.
God, I haven't talked to Jim in a while. He's one of the first people I ever followed on Twitter, actually.
Is he? Look it. Say that again. One of the first people that Peter ever followed.
One of the first people I ever followed on Twitter.
Nice. That's a good one to follow, too. He's something. Just saying. Yeah, so go follow Peter. Peter, I talked to you last June, and were you on
Twitter then. Yet?
Pardon?
What was I? I was fatter then. That much I know.
You were fatter then. You said it first. I don't think you
were. No, it's true. I'll own that, man. I've dropped about 40 pounds.
Yeah, you really have. So, guys, hold on. If you're not getting an echo, I am going to just leave you over here, Facebook Live, because I can. You can just stare at Peter because he's so pretty. Last June, were you on this journey yet?
I was not. The journey of my becoming not a fat ass anymore? No, I was not. I woke up in October and had a... for lack of a better word, a massive wake-up call. I just looked in the mirror at like 3 a.m. I just got back from Bangkok, looked in the mirror at 3 a.m. I did not like what I saw looking back at me. And I said, I need to make a change. And it was, I realized I could also only change me. I couldn't focus on changing other people because you can't do that.
Right.
So that was huge to me. That was this massive wake up call where I realized that I just need to better myself. And here we are. I'm going to move this lamp so that it doesn't have that massive thing.
I'll say hi to somebody that's going to make Dawn pass out. Dawn, who do you think is watching Facebook Live that's going to make you pass out? BK. Let's do the head tilt for BK. Peter Shankman, do you know Brian Kramer?
Of course, Brian. I love Brian Kramer. I secretly want to be Brian Kramer.
Yeah, me too.
Not as much as this girl.
She says, yeah. There's a contest. And I think it could be, you know, an Indian leg wrestling contest or, you know, an arm wrestling for being Brian Kramer. Who says hi, by the way? I logged some serious time with him at South by Southwest. And I actually, you know who I might like better? Sorry, BK, is Courtney. His wife. I'm just saying.
See, I'm a Henry.
And you're a Henry fan too.
I like little Henry.
Hey guys, over here on Facebook, we're going to finish up. Love you guys, long time. Say goodbye to Peter Shankman. Come over to Blab so he can talk to you directly and you guys can get the 411. Bye guys. And we're done. All right, Peter, I'm going to put the headphones in and you tell us when you get ready.
Hi, Emery. Tell me if you hear, tell me, I'm trying to figure out which mic I'm using. Do you hear me better now or now?
Do you have your big boy like this?
Yeah, I do. I just don't know which one it is. Are you hearing me from this one
or from this one?
That one.
Okay. Then I will move this over. All right. Sounds good.
Sounds good.
Gives me a little more room to sit down and sort of
stretch
out a little bit.
Stretch right. out. Yeah, I have my big silver boyfriend. I'm getting ready to go. So, you guys ready? I am actually going to lock the seat. Should I lock the seat, Dawn? I just won't let anybody in. How you like me now? How's that? All right, you guys ready? Here we go. Hey guys, what's up? I'm Mia Voss. Welcome, welcome. Today I'm talking with Peter Shankman. I'm going to drop the mic and walk off the stage and just let him talk because that's all I need to see. So guys, if you don't know Peter, there's something seriously wrong with you. Inventor, the creator of Haro. I like to say it like this, Peter. Haro. What is Haro?
Work. Haro is help reporter out. It was a service I created back in 2007 to connect journalists with sources all around the world. It was acquired in 2010. It's a pretty good service. It's still 100% free. It has about, I think, 500,000 people use it a day.
Still.
Yeah, it sort of changed my life in the respect that I was able to make something that really, really helped a lot of people, and I was able to make a fortune while doing it all from my couch. So that was a bonus. And now I write books, I speak. I have an amazing mastermind for entrepreneurs full of about 130 entrepreneurs all around the world. It's a digital mastermind. It's entirely virtual. It's at shankminds.com. It's yes. 130 brilliant, brilliant people who are just sharing their journeys as entrepreneurs. Because entrepreneurship, and we could touch on this later because I want to talk about self-care and entrepreneur care and all that. Entrepreneurship is lonely as shit, man. It is a lonely, lonely journey, and it's awesome, and I'd recommend it to everyone. But, you know, when you have a bad day, there's not an HR department you can go talk to, or, you know, a team of, you know, you can't go across the lot. And especially if you're the boss,
right?
You know, it's not like you're going to go to the people working for you and say, you know, I really need to talk about my feelings. And so it's a lonely journey. So I'm trying to, in addition to the ADHD stuff, which we'll get into, obviously, I'm trying to make it a little less lonely. And I have a group of about 130 people at shankminds.com. And we're always looking for good, smart entrepreneurs who want to contribute there to join us. It's a good group of people. I'm really proud of them. And I'm glad it's good stuff.
Pull that one together. You know what? I like that line about, you know, have you ever had that on your computer where it says, please consult your IT administrator? And I go like this.
Right. He's currently busy feeding the cats right now. He'll be doing this.
Yeah, he's out walking.
By the way, you're the only person in the world to ever publicly call my cat an asshole. So
please, thank you. So if you guys don't know the context of that, do you like how I sent you that email when you're in Austin? Remember me? I'm the one who called your cat an asshole. So I have Peter on the show last year and he said my cat's name is NASA. And for some odd reason, I was like, your cat's an asshole. But you know what? Your cat was one yesterday.
Yes, actually, I mean, both my cats are assholes, but I love them. I love them dearly, and they tend to wake me up. But, you know, I never sleep in. I'm up by 4 a.m. every day. It's just, it's who I am. It's how I get my best work done. We'll talk about that's ADD as well. But, yeah, yesterday I actually had a little time to sleep in. It was my one off day, and my kid was sleeping, which is great. Yeah. She slept till like 8 o'clock. And I look at the alarm, I look at the clock, it's like 5 a.m. I'm like, this rocks at like 6:50. I'm like, God damn it. Yeah, so.
You know what, Kat? You had one job.
Seriously.
And that was to sleep in. Seriously. So, hold on one second. I might be
getting. Thank you, Invincible's dad. Invincible's AAD. I appreciate that.
Wow. Covered on foot. Nice. Yeah. See, this is what I love about this show, too. You can see all the comments that are coming through. You guys, please make sure to tweet out would be great because it's Peter and because I said so. Hi, I am David Vaughn. So, you know what I like, though, about your mastermind group? So, you guys, if you go to, is it Shankminds, you said?
Shankminds, MINDS.com. Yeah. And
so
it's like 6 lattes a month is basically the cost.
Yeah. And I'm little, let's dog shame me for not joining it yet because after this, I am. Because what I like about your emails, too, it's for really intentional people. Like, you're not messing around if you're going to join this group. Like, get in and get busy, right?
Yep, exactly. And that's the beauty of it is that, and we have everything. I mean, we have people doing meetups. We have people doing, we have a photographer in the group who said, hey, I'm a photographer and I have Sunday free. If you could find a studio for us and anyone in New York can go get their headshots, anyone in our group. So 20 people showed up and we all had our headshots, professional headshots done. Like right there, you just paid for your year, you know? But yeah, it's good stuff.
Well, I think it's the ultimate crowdsourcing with really cool people. So it's A-listers because you already have people that have a really great resource. So it's awesome for that too. So let's also talk about the other day I'm on Snapchat and I get the Snapchat message from Peter that goes, answer your damn emails. I'm like, I'm on a beach, bitch, I believe was my answer to you. And then I got back immediately. Yeah, because I had the opportunity to talk with Peter about what I find is really important, this topic. So of course, you know, I've joined the Faster Than Normal originally, but then I really started looking at it this weekend. And I got to tell you, I'm really excited, brother, because I think you're doing something amazing with this. So can you tell me how you got to this journey and what started this for you?
You know, I think, look, I've always known I've been ADD. You know, you break your arm, you see your bone sticking out of your arm. You don't need a doctor to tell you you broke your arm. You got to figure out ways to fix it. So, I mean, for me, I've always known that I was ADHD. That's nothing new. I think for me, though, the difference is about 15 or so years ago when I realized, holy shit, this is a gift. You know, I can use this to my advantage. And I remember the first time I did that, I think, you know, if you think back to it, I mean, the first time was college. We were divided. I was always the kid who, you know, if they divided up the class in like groups of five and had us work on projects, I was always the kid who like said, okay, the hell with you all, give me your work, I'll type it up. You know, the night before, I was like typing everything up the night before, getting everything done. You know, and I always knew. You learn. I mean, the problem is that I didn't learn early enough. And so my childhood kind of sucked. I mean, I shouldn't say.
Yes.
I had great parents. I still do. They're wonderful people. I love them both. They follow me on Twitter. Hi, mom, dad. But the thing about me was that I was, when you're ADD, ADHD, the tendency to be socially awkward increases.
I know.
Add to the fact that I was a fat Jewish kid from New York, and that just grew. So I had very few friends growing up. Was very much a the loud one, the kid who didn't pay attention, the kid who I mean, I was funny. Everyone thought I was hysterical, but I was the clown a la Goodfellas with Joe Pesci. Amuse you how? Like a clown, you know? Like,
what do you mean funny?
Exactly. What do you mean funny? Like, I was hysterical to them, but I was never cool hysterical, so I was never invited to the parties.
Right.
You know? And so for me, I never knew. I just figured I was a fuck up. I figured there was always something wrong with me and always something.
It's isolating.
Isolating. And, you know, and I remember thinking, okay, I'm going to drown myself in work because that's how I'm going to do better. And work will be the thing that I do the best or whatever, you know. And then, of course, I got my first job at America Online and didn't give a shit what you did as long as you got it done. So that was awesome. But then I left AOL, came back to New York, and my second job for like 3 weeks was in an office. And, you know, what do you mean I have to be in by 9 a.m. What do you mean I have to fill out reports? Not so good. And that's when I realized, okay, something's wrong. And I was fortunate enough that I just had the guts to say, okay, I'm going to try going out on my own. And October 28th, 1998, I incorporated. And I told the guy who was my attorney at the time, I said, I'm going to go out on my own, help me incorporate my company. And I said, when it fails, I'll get a job, but at least I can have a month to not have to work. But, that was 18 years ago, and it's yet to feel like work. So I got very lucky. I got very lucky that I realized how I work and how I work best, and I've been able to incorporate that. But every day is, you know, a new challenge and a new learning scenario. You have to understand. My friend Dr. Ned Halliwell, who is like the ADD Godfather. He wrote the book that changed my life. It was called Delivered from Distraction. And Delivered from Distractions, the opening, I'm going to read you the opening line of that book. Hang on.
Was your very first podcast, right?
I launched Faster Than Normal with him, and I was so fortunate. Awesome. The best quote that he opens the book with is, having ADD or ADHD makes life paradoxical. You can super focus sometimes, but also space out when you least mean to. You can radiate confidence and also feel as insecure as a cat in a kennel. You could perform at the highest level, feeling competent as you do so. You could be loved by many, but feel as if no one really likes you. You can absolutely, totally intend to do something, then forget to do it. You can have the greatest ideas in the world, but feel like you can't accomplish a thing. I read that probably 10 years ago, and I'm not even joking, Mia. I sat on the floor bawling my fucking eyes out for like an hour because, holy shit, that's what I had. That was me. And it was, I mean, I get chills still thinking about it. It was just a wake-up call beyond wake-up calls, because I realized that what I had, this thing I had, A, had a name, and B, could be beneficial.
Yes.
If I learned how to use it. And so I have set up over the last 15, 20 years without even realizing it, I've set up little life rules, and I'll give you my top five later, but these life rules keep me alive. They keep me humble.
Yeah.
And I'll be honest. And I'm admitting this in public. I've admitted this before. I believe on any given day, I am three bad decisions in a row away from being a junkie in the streets. And I am honest about that because being honest about it keeps me real. The day I start lying to myself about it is the day I lose everything I have. My wife, my kid, my career.
Right.
You know,
I think it sheds a light on it instead of having something really big in the closet that's dark.
Exactly. And more importantly, I know that it's an incredible benefit to have. Yes. But I also know that, you know, with great power comes great responsibility, right? So, mm-hmm. you know, it is a gift and it is tremendous power to have, but I need to also be very much aware of what triggers it, how I benefit from it, and how I can be cursed by it. So eventually, you know, 4 or 5, 6 months ago, whatever, I just for the hell of it, I had enough people ask me and say, hey, why do you get up at 4 a.m.? Why do you do certain things the way you do? And I said, oh, it's all the benefit of my ADHD. And a bunch of people said, oh, we'd love to hear more about that. So I did a webinar on it.
Yeah.
And I figured I'd get 100 people maybe to show up. And I had like 8,000 people on the webinar and like, yeah.
At the start, it was like 400, and then it just grew.
Thousands have downloaded it since. So, you know, I'm like, well, shit, there's something here. And so I did my homework, and I realized that there are very few people, if any, who are voicing about ADD or talking about ADD as a gift. Everyone's talking about, okay, here's the medication you need, here's the therapy. What about it being a gift and it being a benefit? And so I decided to do something about it. You know, I'm not doing it for the money. I'm doing it because I believe there's something that needs to be said. And instead of a 5-year, you know, you get a 5-year-old out there who's being creative and acting like a 5-year-old. And instead of throwing him on medication so he can act like a 40-year-old, how about letting him run the hell around outside for an hour because he's 5? You know, and that really just gets me. So
that's the best distinction, by the way. I've never heard it put that way, but that's exactly what it is, because it really just takes everything off the table of being a kid.
Yeah. Someone said to me, the best line I ever heard was, having a headache does not mean you have an aspirin deficiency. Right. So you want to figure out why you have a headache. So if a kid is unable to learn, like I was, I mean, for Christ's sake, I was the worst student until those rare classes where I had a teacher who got me. And since I had a teacher who got me and let me learn the way I wanted to, I was an A student, right? And my parents could never understand how I could be getting C's in 5 classes and an A in 2.
Right.
How are you not applying yourself in those 5 classes? Like, no, I'm applying myself just as hard. It's not working, and I couldn't figure out why.
And that's the most frustrating feeling. You know who I love? The kid that came on, and he's a kid, Daniel Coe.
Oh, Daniel Coe. Yeah, he's awesome. So Daniel Howard Coe is the chief of staff to the mayor of Boston. If you ever seen the movie The American President, he's Michael J. Fox's character, right? He's just like, I mean, this kid, there's no doubt he's going to be the chief of staff to a president in like 12 years. There's no question about it. But he's gifted. And he talks all about how he grew up with ADD and ADHD and Adderall and all that. And you know, he used to take medication. Now he doesn't. And look, let me tell you, I'm not anti-med. Okay. Right. I actually have a prescription for Concerta, and I take Concerta. I call it my expense report medication because I take it on the days that Megan, my assistant, says, Peter, if you do not get your expense reports to me by 12 p.m., your clients will not pay you. And she's like, I've been telling you about this for 3 weeks. It is due today at noon. Go do it. And so I'll take a Concerta, and I will, half an hour later, it's like the scene in Limitless where Bradley Cooper takes the pill and like it goes from black, you know, grayscale to color. Ooh, you know, and all of a sudden I could focus. Yeah, yeah, literally.
Beautiful mind.
Fish-eyed, and I can just, but I do that the same way when I give a speech, when I exercise, when I skydive. There's a reason that I'm addicted to jumping out of planes. Come on. You know, it's that same hit of dopamine and adrenaline. But if I don't have time to jump out of a plane, or if I don't, you know, I have the medication as a backup, but I don't use it every day. It's a when I need it scenario. And I don't need it that often. And that's actually very beneficial. You know, so I'm not anti-medication. I just think that it should probably be a last resort. Bill Reed 72 is correct. It is called dopamine.
By the way, all my squirrel friends are in the audience.
Oh, I'm sure they are.
This is my favorite squirrels.
The J-Date profile I had before I found the person I married, actually, it's the last dating profile I ever had. Actually, my screen name was the chemical makeup for dopamine. And it's great because it weeded out like 90% of the people I wouldn't want to talk to because they didn't know what it was.
Sure.
So my dates were either people who understood chemically geared toward chemistry, or cokeheads, because it's only one molecule away from cocaine. So yeah, I had some interesting dates.
I like how you're on J-Date. By the way, I need to shout out, do you know Brian Fanzo?
Yes.
So he's in the audience. He's my little brother from another mother. Love him. I thank you for pinging him in. Somebody pinged him in as well, because he is definitely, what did he say? He's a transparent.
Yep.
He's a transparent ADHD, which I think is fantastic. And you know what? Are you watching the comments too? That everybody, it looks like they're getting their own little recipe as well. So you figured out your recipe, which you're going to share some of your hacks and tips on that too, because that's what I'm loving as well. I mean, I honestly, until I started joining your group, it really was, it always has been like disability. So I love how you're moving it from that word to a superpower, you know, couched with tools.
No one would ever say, if someone gave you a Lamborghini, you wouldn't say, oh, you know what? That's a disability car. I'd really prefer a Honda. No, you drive a Lamborghini. Problem is, though, if you don't know how to drive it, you'll crash into a tree and kill yourself. So what I'm doing is I'm trying to explain to people that, you know what, having a faster brain, having a brain that goes a thousand times faster than everyone else, dude, that's a gift, as long as you know how to use it. Hallowell has a great quote. We have Ferrari brains with Honda, with Hyundai brakes. Right? So we have to have better brakes. We have to understand how to use our brains, how to drive it, drive them better. But my God, I wouldn't trade this gift I have. I wouldn't trade it for anything. What I'm able to get done, you know, if I've set the conditions right, are better than anyone else.
You know, I love Fanzo just said, which I love. He says he does Adderall drug holidays, so no meds on the weekends, which allows him to
sleep around. Same thing. I will never take meds on weekends. I'll never take meds when I'm speaking. I'll never take it when I'm skydiving. I'll never take it on an airplane, because those are my places where I can focus. The only time I have to take it is when I need that. You put me in a 3-hour legal the day I sold Harrow, right? 6 hours in a lawyer's office. I wanted to blow my brains out. I took it then. You know, those are the kind of things. If you have to have me sit down for 5 hours and talk, yes, I'll take a pill.
Yeah. My line, Peter, is that I became an entrepreneur because I can't stand meetings.
Yeah.
And I control like what meetings I go to. I can control the environment that I'm in. I need a little safety valve. I take what's called propranolol for occasional, I have anxiety attacks. Mm-hmm. But if I speak in a really big thing, this, I'm good, but I keep that off to the side.
Put me in a room full of 30,000 people and I will charm the shit out of every single one from the stage, and I'll be awesome. Give me if I have to throw a party, you know, I'd rather slice my eyeballs open with a spork, because having to entertain and amuse six people at one time and make sure everyone's having fun. Are you having a good time?
Yes.
Oh, no, I'd rather drown myself. So, yeah, I get that. I totally get that.
I think we talked about this when I interviewed you last year. Do you consider yourself an ambivert as well?
I'm the most introverted extrovert you'll ever meet in your life.
Yeah, I'm a gregarious loner, I say. Outgoing introvert.
Extroverted introvert, I don't remember. No, introverted extrovert.
It's introvert, exactly. Yeah, because people see us, right? And they're just like, hey, what's up, life of the party? So I'm loving that. Which, by the way, I got to give you a little shout out. I have my phone turned off. But I watched you did a live thing where you talked about putting your icons on your iPhone into folders. Boom. We should talk about that. Yeah. Like, seriously, you guys. Because then I was like going through and scrolling. Mm-hmm.
Game changer. Hang on.
Total
game changer. Everything is set the way it should be with, what is it? Business, entertainment, food and drink, games, Google, health and wellness, finance, messaging, news and finance, shopping, social, travel, utilities. And then I keep certain apps, and this is actually a tip, I keep certain apps that I use religiously on the homepage. So Gmail, Google, Calendar, Twitter, Facebook, Wonderlist, Snapchat, an app called Productive, Google Maps, Instagram, Shazam, and Mentions, Facebook Mentions. Those are on the main page. Yep. And then everything else is in folders.
Is in folders, yeah, exactly. No, so travel, productivity, the whole thing. I have that as well. Brian says,
I'll screenshot. Yeah. I'll screenshot my home.
Please
my
do.
Home,
and you guys, page. You need to go over right now, write meow, and go over to Faster Than Normal. That's it. Because not only do you have blog posts, but you have all the podcasts as well.
Yeah, jump on the go to fasttheNormal.com, and if you could, I would greatly appreciate it. Sign up, click on the podcast, go to iTunes, You can either search for Faster Than Normal on iTunes or go through fasternormal.com. Please subscribe and leave a review, because that the more reviews that are positive that we get on iTunes, the more they will promote the podcast, yes, and the more it can actually help people with it.
And that's the deal too.
For any other reason.
Yes, and that's the deal too. You are doing this. Yeah, I mean, it's seriously, I mean, when I posted this, people were like, "Rrr." I mean, they got really excited about it, because I don't think anybody's ever heard it spoken in that way about a superpower. So
hang on, yeah. 1 second. I'm still here. Okay. Hang on.
That's Peter Shankman, ladies and gentlemen. You guys, so if you're just now joining the show, I'm Mia Voss. That's Peter Shankman. We're talking about the superpower of the ADD and the ADHD mind. Go to fasterthannormal.com.
I'm in it. So I have a Regis office. I'm in a Regis space because I worked in my apartment for 18 years, and I got married and had a kid. And so now this is basically all I own, these jeans and this shirt. So I can't spend time in my apartment anymore because I have the kid or the nanny or the grandparents or whatever. So I
or Fox News.
Or Fox News. Best $1,500 I ever spent is this Regis little office. It's about the size of me. I mean, there's just enough room, but it's awesome because I can close the door and
yes,
get into the zone. And that's actually the first tip I'll give you is find your happy place for, you know, for ADD and ADHD. The problem is our brains work best when we're focused on it could be five things, but when we're focused on something. So for me, when I write, the worst thing in the world is to be interrupted.
Yes.
And so I use a wonderful app called OMWriter, O-M-M Writer. Mm-hmm. OMWriter actually shuts off all of the background activity in your computer and only allows you to have that one window open. So nothing else shows up. The rest of the computer is blank. OMM Writer. And it's great because you could just start typing. And it plays little peaceful, like Enya-type music in the background. Put on your headphones, and you just go to town. And if I don't look up, or if I don't set an alarm or something, it'll be 6 hours, and I'll still type. It'll be like 11 p.m. here, and there's no one there. So that's great. I love OMWriter. But, you know, so that's the whole – so this office is one of my happy places. If I had to do a lot of writing at home, the cat or the kid or the internet or whatever. Sure. And so it's worth the $1,500 a month. The amount of productivity I get is worth having this office. That's another thing. You know, don't be afraid to spend money on things that might seem stupid. Oh, I have a perfectly good home office. Why should I buy it? If it works for you, then there's benefit to
it. And it's very specific.
And if you produce more based on how much you charge or whatever, then yeah.
Then that's worth the cost. I mean, just the idea of that, of 6 hours, that sounds amazing because I know.
I'm not even joking. I've stood up sometimes and like I creak because I have not physically moved in. I'm like, oh. You know, my iPhone watch that says, you know, time to stand up for an hour. You know, like by 6 hours, like, I'm just going to fucking quit. Don't stand up. I don't care.
I'm just going to roll over. Like, just
seriously.
Just
no, it's,
which,
I mean, you know the story behind Zombie Loyalists, how I wrote the book.
Tell everybody.
I had 8 months. I signed the contract to write the book for 8 months. And I had an eight month window to write it. I did all the research the first month. And then with 2 weeks left, my publisher called me and said, hey, it's 2 weeks left. You know, you get the book done yet? I'm like, totally. Yeah, I'm completely on
it. You like
this, though? I've not written shit. Yeah. So I hung up, booked a flight. There we go. Booked a flight to Tokyo for the next day and got on the plane with my laptop and I think a box of almonds. And
that's random. I like it.
Wrote chapters 1 through 5 on the flight from Newark to Tokyo. Landed in Tokyo. Went to the airport lounge at Narita, took a shower, had a cup of coffee, didn't even clear immigration, got back on the same seat, same plane 2 hours later, wrote chapters 6 through 10 on the flight home, landed 31 hours after I took off for the book, and then got detained by Homeland Security because I never actually cleared immigration in Tokyo, so they thought I was smuggling something. But yeah. That's how I wrote my book. And, you know, everyone thought I was crazy. Oh, my God, you spent $6,000 on a business class ticket for what? I'm like, well, to get a best-selling novel out of it. And, you know, yeah, I don't think that's necessarily, you know, to me, that's worth every penny. You know, I made this
thing.
And,
which if you guys haven't gotten that, then you've got to do it. And Peter,
if you go to zombieloyalists.com, there are discounts and fun stuff like that. But, yeah, I mean, I had a blast writing the book. And for me, you know, I literally landed 31 hours later and it didn't feel, I was like, oh, I guess, yeah, it is 2 days later, you know, but it totally worked for me.
So, and I think that's what you're, again, we're talking about recipe, like for everybody. And I'm loving like all the, everybody is just, cause a lot of, obviously a lot of people that are in the audience here do a lot like we do. They're working with brands. They're working, they're working on strategy, things like that. Well, we also don't really have a boss, which means that if we're not told, if we don't get our shit together, we're just all over the place. I know for myself, Peter, sometimes I'll just do like Facebook for me lately is just a problem because I come back, I've been on these trips, I'm doing travel blogging. And so I'm constantly like, okay, you know, and I get, it's like, it's busy work. It's like, oh, I should just keep.
Well, that brings up a great, another tip that I'll give you. I've come up with this term called short burst downtime.
Ooh.
Short burst downtime is the 5 minutes when you are waiting online somewhere, okay? Or the 6 minutes that you're dead stopped in traffic, or the, I don't know, whatever you're waiting for. You're waiting for your partner to finish shopping, or you're waiting for your kid to wake up from the nap. Something that's not planned. So airplane downtime is long burst downtime. You plan for that. Okay, I'm flying tomorrow. I'm gonna do this. Short burst is when you don't have the time. And so for me, I always have my phone with me. I always have a backup charger with me. And so short burst downtime gives me 6 minutes, 7 minutes, 8 minutes to answer a whole bunch of emails, to post some status updates, do a quick Facebook Live, whatever the case may be. And in doing that, I can save basically 2 hours of my day. So when I get home at 6 p.m., okay, now I first have to get to bed, then I have to spend another 2 hours. No, it's all done. So short burst downtime is great because if you actually add up all the time that you spend wasting it during the day, whether it's, you know, my warm-ups and cool-downs.
Restart.
At the gym,
restart, right?
My warm-ups and cool-downs in the gyms are probably 30 minutes, you know, 15-minute walk, 15-minute walk, or 15-minute bike, 15-minute bike, in between the hard stuff, the lifting, right? That's 30 minutes that I can be on my phone.
Yeah.
Answering emails, posting status updates. Social fans calls it pockets of time. Exactly. Same concept. Whatever it is, it could be other things too. It could be online shopping.
Yes.
Right? Morning on the treadmill for 15 minutes, I Googled where the best flaxseed. I wound up with flaxseed. You know, so stop the GNC
on
the
way off. So
it's like, what?
Did a drone drop it off?
Blink. So for me, that's really the best way to get that. To build in that time.
Yes.
And that's a tool I use.
And that's also that the habit which I'm loving. By the way, Jed Record, nice to see you in here. Jed just said something, we'll segue because Jed said something about wine, because everybody knows me for wine. However, I know that's been a changer for you. Let's talk about that. That was one of your things that you realized was not your superpower.
So I will tell you that.
And Jed, you know me well.
Come on. No judging. I am, as of today, it has been 157 minutes since I quit drinking.
157 days.
I'm sorry, 157
no, that's
days.
Me. That would be me. You're 157 days.
Oh my God, I'm so pretty. I am so pretty.
You are.
It's been 157 days since I quit drinking. And I got it. Mia calls that community between bars. I love it. No, that was probably the best decision I ever made. And look, I am not going to get preaching and tell you to quit drinking. Dude, that is your own shit. Everyone in the world needs to deal with that the way they want. If you love me, knock yourself out.
Yeah, that's
that is
more
not
for me,
why I'm
Peter.
Here.
Because when I come to New York, I'll be like, hey, more booze for me.
So,
and I'll go hang out with Peter.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So not why I'm here. I just know what works for me and what doesn't work for me. And the problem with me is that I drink the same way I eat pizza. I have a next door neighbor in this Regis space who came in about a month or so ago, and she goes, hey, we had a meeting last night and we had pizza and there's some leftover pizza in the fridge. And I looked at her and I'm like, are you a witch? What the fuck is leftover? What the hell is leftover pizza? Who has leftover pizza? I order pizza, I eat the pizza. What the leftover pizza? It's like leftover wine. So for me, I simply don't have the ability to moderate.
Yeah.
And I've accepted that. It is who I am.
Yeah. That's that transparency too. Like there's no shame in it. It just.
Exactly. And I never did anything stupid. Thank God. I would, if I was going out drinking, I'd leave my phone home. You know, I wouldn't tweet drunk. But on the flip side, the amount of domain names I bought when I was drunk is staggering. You know, some people drive drunk. I buy domain names and I wake up the next morning with a headache going, what the fuck does this even mean? You know, and the interesting thing for me is that I didn't gain weight or do stupid shit when I was drunk. But by quitting, several things happen. So first off, it allows me, when you go out drinking or you go to a client event or you go to a party, time ceases to be time when you're drinking. Oof. You know, if I go out at 7 p.m. and have one drink, midnight comes a lot quicker than when I'm not drinking. When I'm not drinking, I put the kid to bed at 8 o'clock. Yeah, I put the kid to bed at 8 o'clock. I'm asleep by 9, which allows me to get up at 3:45 when I do and go to the gym.
Right.
When I go out drinking, when I used to go out drinking, you know, it's midnight, it's 1 a.m., it's 2 a.m., I'm getting home, I feel like crap. I wake up, my alarm goes off at 4 a.m. to go to the gym, and I, no way in hell, I shut it off. I wake up at 7, I feel like crap, I'm dehydrated. I fix that by ordering in shitty food.
Yes.
Right? Then I just feel dehydrated and greasy. So now it's done. So the best line I ever heard is that having a drink for me is a 3-day process.
Gotcha.
Right? I don't want to waste 3 of my days just by having a drink. So for me, I just gave it up. And let's face it, when you do things incredibly fast, like this, I go through 8 of these. This is water, my wonderful New York Post water bottle. I go through 8 full things of this a day. I drink alcohol the same way.
Oh, gotcha.
Okay.
Right.
I mean, I would put a glass of I had my drink of choice is tequila. I had Patron Silver on the rocks. Put a glass of Patron Silver in me. I will sip it and drink it and drink it and drink it. And next thing I know, I've had 4 of them, 6 of them, 8 of them. And let me tell you something, it's incredibly easy to do stupid shit. Or let me rephrase that. Your ability to say no to things that would be an automatic no after you've had 4 drinks or when you haven't drank are a lot hard.
Yeah.
Fuck my drink. You know what I'm trying to say?
And it's like this, you go, that sums it up, right?
You know,
I can do it.
I would never ever conceivably do when I haven't been drinking, all of a sudden, you know, are things that, oh, well, let me think about that. You know, I would never say, wow, cocaine, you know, or something stupid like that, right?
But not seemed like a good idea and a good at the good time.
Right.
I never seen I was in New York in the 80s.
So the basic premise is for me, I don't know how to moderate. I'm very all or nothing.
Yeah.
And so I just rather,
but that's what I,
it's work. You remember the movie War Games?
Yes.
Of course you do. You're old. Remember the movie War Games? I love you, man. The best line in the world from War Games: the only winning move is not to play.
Oh God, that's right. I'm always in the. Yeah, it really was.
I won't win if I'm drinking.
I love this. Sober up and realize you that have an 8-ball of blow and hookers in your hotel room.
Okay, I've never said that I did that.
No, somebody said John Cronic.
There's no proof.
That's John Cronic, apparently. He's just
that's John Cronic. Because yeah, there's no proof for me of that, John. And John, quite frankly, if you're sobered up and still have an 8-ball left, you're doing it wrong. But that's, you know, it's the basic premise that for me, I like being better. And the way for me to be better is to eliminate the things. I call it elimination of choice. Okay, if I don't have the choice to drink or the choice to go out or the choice to do whatever, I won't do it.
Yeah.
And the best example I can give you that is I have 2 outfits in my world. When I'm not going on television or giving a speech, I have a t-shirt, either long or short sleeve, and jeans. All right. I have like 10 long sleeve t-shirts. This one happens to say Rochester, New York. But they could say anything. I have one obviously that says Harrow because, Harrow. You know, if you have any idea how much Harrow clothing I have, you know. So there's my hair. So long story short, when I'm not on TV, t-shirt, jeans, sneakers. When I am on TV or giving a speech, button-down shirt, jacket, jeans, sneakers. That's it. I have 2 suits, you know, for like the high holy Jewish holidays or a funeral, and that's it. That's all that's in my closet.
You kept it really simple.
I kept it simple. I got rid of everything else because number one, I have a kid out of the room. But number two, it's
and you live in New York.
If I had to think about it though every morning, okay, now what should I? Oh, that oh God, I remember when I got that shirt. I got that shirt when I went to that thing. Oh, that thing. God, I should go look at photos of that thing. It's 6 hours later. I haven't left my apartment. So eliminate the choice.
Yes.
And you don't have to worry about it.
Disruption.
So I public speak all around the world. Corporate gigs, huge corporate gigs for major companies. My contract is literally short bus simple. I will speak. You will pay me. Right? That's it. I've had everyone tells me that I have the easiest contract in the world, except when I'm speaking in Las Vegas. If I have a speech in Las Vegas, I have a rider in the contract that says speaker will only keynote at 12:30 p.m. And speaker does not have to be on the ground in Las Vegas from wheels down to wheels up for more than 8 hours.
Wow.
So I will take a 6 a.m. flight out of Newark. I'll land at 10:30 Vegas time. I'll keynote at 12:30. I'll be back on a 4 p.m. flight out of Vegas.
Get the hell out
because
of here.
Because if I have a 9 a.m. keynote, that means I have to come in the night before. And let me tell you something. Nothing good will come from me with 8 hours unsupervised in Las Vegas. It won't. There will be nothing beneficial. And so rather than – and look, I'm not saying I can't do it.
You're just smart. You know what? It's the elimination.
Why give myself the opportunity? Why not just make it easier and not have to deal with it?
You know what? Frank Clark Coach is saying, know thyself. And Fanzo, if you'd like to come on, darling, that would be –
know thyself.
Yeah.
God bless.
Exactly. God bless. It really – and it is. So, again, these are Peter's things. I've got my things as well, too. And I love – I think you talked about in your webinar, too, about the distraction. So that these are distractions or disruption, things being neat, things being organized, things like that. And then again, I have a personal assistant. I'll out myself. She came in and just cleaned up out of my house because I've been traveling, and that's what she does well. You know what I mean?
So Megan Walker, my wonderful assistant.
Shout out to Megan.
You can send her a tweet. She's what the hell? M Walker 117 on Twitter. Mm-hmm. And the greatest thing about Megan is that. I had her for 7 years and I fired her for 3 months because I wanted her to do a better job. And then it turns out we couldn't live without each other. So we're married again. And she's working for me again. But the best thing she ever did was take away write access to my calendar.
Oh,
so
yes.
I actually don't have write access to my calendar. She controls it. Hey, Brian.
Yes, little brother.
So yeah, for me, it's, you know, it's great. So if someone wants to have it happen to you, when she said, you said to me, okay, Peter, when should we book? I'm like, no, talk to me. And it's not because I'm that guy, but it's because I know better. If I booked you, I guarantee you I'd be on a plane when we were supposed to be talking.
Yep.
Right? And the reason Megan took everything away from me in the first place was because I accidentally booked two dinners on the same night, which I didn't think was that big of a deal until Megan told me that I booked them on separate continents.
My bad.
And the whole reason I hired Megan in the first place, actually even better, was because I got my first, it was like 7 years ago, 8 years ago, I got my first speaking gig in Singapore. And I was so psyched that I booked my ticket and they paid for my business class ticket. Oh, it's awesome. I'm going to get the airport. They're like, okay, we're going to Shanghai. I'm going to Singapore. It's like, okay, so this is a ticket for Shanghai.
Starts with an S.
Right. I'm going to Singapore. It's like, right, you booked a ticket to Shanghai. And I was in such shock. I swear to God, I actually looked at the woman. I'm like, okay, well, are they close? Can I rent a car? She's like, sir, no, they're not.
There's one.
That was a $3,000 mistake. Right. After that, we got
to
Megan.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, yeah, she does. So you need to have your people to keep you tight and upright, I like to say. And that's their superpower. So you find out what their superpower, which again, this girl, like, she loves organizing. She does that.
Hire people who are amazing at the shit you suck at. End of story.
Actually, yeah, that's it right there. That's the home run. For me, I actually said my 2 years of owning my own LLC is officially today. So 2 years today. Yeah. Thank you. But it probably took me 18 months of that 2 years to identify what I was not good at so I could surround myself with people who were good at the shit I wasn't good at, right?
And like, sure.
That was the mistake, I think, from me as an entrepreneur. And I thought solopreneur meant I had to do everything myself. And someone with ADHD, trying to do everything yourself just means I do a lot of things and drop a lot of balls. And
yeah.
And that goes back to what I talked about earlier about paying for things that are worth paying for. So, you know, stupid shit. Like when I land in a city that has, a perfect example. I am 43 years old. I've done pretty well successful, you know, professionally. I can afford to have a car waiting for me at Newark Airport when I land, except for the fact that I am smart enough to know that taking a $15 air train from the airport during rush hour will actually get me to the city like 10 times faster.
Right.
And so the biggest advice I can give in that regard, especially with ADD, is you're going to do things differently and you're going to be considered weird. And once you stop caring what other people think about you and your traits, that right there is the moment that you're free.
Damn.
And so I'll be sitting on an airplane. This happened last week. I was flying back from San Francisco to LA, and I was on the plane, and I was, I got my upgrades. I'm bopping along. I'm in like 3A in business class. And I had something, I don't know what I was listening to. I was something. And I was listening to, it was great music. I was totally working and whatever. And and I look up and there's like three flight attendants. They're giggling because I'm like,
in the zone.
You know, and I just keep it going. And that's my thing. I know what works for me. And if I get into that kind of a zone, that kind of mood, I'm hot, I'm good, things are working. What do I give a shit about?
It's firing on all pistons. I really think it is figuring about, again, like it doesn't matter if it's the workout thing, if it's getting your, you said you sleep in your workout clothes.
I do. I sleep in my workout clothes. And I, so when I wake up at about 3:45, the only thing I have to do, 4 a.m., the only thing I have to do is put on my sneakers, brush my teeth, and out the door.
Right.
And so for me, that's a very, very easy, simple hack that anyone can do. And also, I mean, another hands down huge hack that I use constantly is you want to have the ability to trust in the data. Men lie, women lie, kids lie. Data does not lie. And so
that's right.
For me, Pamela Parker, Peter Shankman, you don't shower before working out in the morning. I used to have this thing where I'd shower before I worked out. You know, Pamela, what I realized once I cut my hair, once I started shaving my head, no, I didn't, because it wasn't exactly, it wasn't so much about feeling gross. It's about my hair flying all over the place and looking like a flock of seagulls. So for me, it's a lot easier. No, if the hair is, I can just rub water on my face.
Yeah, your DTD. But that's a new change that you made as well. That it's like efficiency.
Exactly. Well, you know, so what was I saying?
Isn't that something on the same point though? Like I think, you know, for me when I started to, so I built a team out. I was in cybersecurity and I had 32 direct reports that were reported to me deploying in cybersecurity. And when I took everyone out of the office and I started allowing everybody to work from home and we traveled a lot, it was the element of I allowed people to learn and work where they fit best. Who the hell decided that we all work 9 to 5 most productive, right? And I feel for me personally, that was another big point from my career was it was 9 to 5, 9 to 5. And then all of a sudden, because of the boss at the time allowed me to stop working 9 to 5, my success drastically went up because I can do a lot of stuff during 9 to 5, but my most productive hours are usually at night, mainly because I get a little bit less distractions. A lot of people go to bed where there's not as much posting, a lot as much things, and I can zone in. But I think that's an interesting piece in the culture. I always say the easiest time for me in business and social is when I stopped trying to tell the story that others wanted to hear and started just telling my story. But that's a hard thing to do. I don't think it's as easy as for, you know, that we would love to, for it to be.
Totally.
But I'll tell you something. The other thing about that. Okay. Sorry, Mia. The other thing for me is that I find that when I'm overseas, it's tremendously beneficial because I can work. I was in the Philippines a month ago for a conference and I had 5 days of working. You know, what essentially was 5 a.m. to 5 p.m. or 5 p.m. to 5 a.m. to like 8 p.m. Philippines time, which was like, you know, 5 p.m. to 8 a.m., whatever the hell, New York time. And so no one was bothering me. But yeah, you figure out what, and I'm just because I'm an early riser does not mean I shit on people who are late. I used to be a night person. And if that works for you, man, totally own it. You know, for me, I like getting sleep and knowing, because my morning time, I don't get to the gym, doesn't open until 5:30. I'm part of a group called the Door Club, where the people who are waiting at the door at 5:30 are like, come on, let us in, you know. But, so between 3:45 and 5:30, I can get an hour 15 of work done, and no one bothers me. So yeah, that's of course I'm also the guy who got arrested for exercising in Central Park before.
I saw that.
So you know, they actually arrested me for sent me a summons for being in Central Park before it opened. It was my fault. The cop asked me what I was doing, and I said giving handjobs for crack. Because I mean, what the fuck do you think I'm doing? I'm exercising.
I thought it was funny, right? I want you to follow both of these guys because these guys are doing, you guys are so similar in the sense that you're speaking a ton, you're traveling a ton, you get a shit of done all the time. And that's the other thing too. I'm sure you guys probably get that. Oh, you work too much, you're doing this, but you know what? You've both figured out how to do things incredibly efficiently and you get a lot of stuff done in a shorter amount of time. Boom.
I feel like Brian and I have spoken at the same conferences.
We have. Sure. I think we ever did the guy. I think you did Icon. Infusionsoft's conference in Phoenix.
We'll blow up when you two together.
4 years ago. But Peter, I'm curious from this one. So for me, you were talking about outsourcing and turning over your calendar and having an assistant. And I just recently walked into that world and it's light years of difference for me. But the thing I struggled with, and I don't know if it was the ADHD side, was identifying what the hell I was willing to give up. That because I kind of believe that if I am willing to focus on something, I can do anything. I can do every single task. So how do you kind of look at that for identifying where to get, because it's not only what I suck at, but it's what I suck at, what I don't like doing, and then what I waste a lot of time on, because I can build a website. I just spend, you know, 4 days doing it when someone else I could hire could do it in 4 hours.
Right.
That's a really good point. For me, I find that the non-negotiable, I have a few non-negotiables, things I will not give up. Time with my daughter. Mm-hmm. That's number one. That goes without saying. She's 3 years old and she's just fucking awesome. I will not give up any time with her and I will, that's non-negotiable. For me, I find that I ask myself what's more important. It really just comes down to priorities. You know, when I quit drinking and started working out, and not the two are mutually exclusive, but when I decided to get healthy again, I said, okay, if I want to do this, the only time I can go to the gym where I can't be bothered in it, because I know I can also talk myself out of anything. So I know that if I'm going to go to the gym, it has to be a no-brainer. It has to be first thing in the morning. If that's the case, I need to get at least 6 hours of sleep, 7 hours of sleep. What do I need to do to make sure I do that? I have to give up things that happen late at night. What happens late at night? And I realized nothing really that important. You know, the occasional time every once in a while where I'll go out to dinner with my wife or a client or someone, you know, or see a show or whatever, fine, I'll be tired the next day. But overall, what am I missing by saying, hey, let's meet for drinks, that couldn't be accomplished by, hey, let's have a coffee at 7:30 as I'm walking back from the gym, or let's have a Skype call in the middle of the day?
Yeah.
And the answer is almost virtually nothing. So for me, I realized it comes down to priorities. You keep what's important and you give up what's not. That's it. You know, at the end of the day, that really is it for anything.
It's choice. It's a lot of choice. Shay Sparks wants to know, do you have any types to stop, I think she means tips, to stop procrastination? I'm listening.
Tips to stop. Yes, actually I have a great one. So I am a huge fan of the concept that soon is not an actuality.
Oof.
If a client says to me, hey, when do you need this? Oh, just get it to us whenever. You're never going to fucking get it.
Yeah.
Okay? Amen. You're just not gonna get it. So the best way for me to stop procrastinating is to make sure that everything given to me has a finite date. Megan knows that if I have to do my expense reports, Peter, you have to get the expense reports by Wednesday at noon or you're not going to get paid. I have no idea if that's true or not, but I believe that it is because that's what she told me. Mm-hmm. And she knows that as long as I have a finite deadline, it will get done. I might have to hide under a rock or take a plane trip and fly to Tokyo to do it, but I'll get it done. And so for me, soon is not an actuality. Nothing gets accomplished with soon. You know, it's the same thing with, okay, you want to train for an Ironman triathlon? The first time I did an Ironman triathlon, 2010, God, I have to train for this thing. I don't know how I'm going to do this a year. God, it's a year in advance. Okay, fine. I will buy the non-refundable entrance fee. $800 later, you're going to train for it.
Yeah.
Right? So when you buy that ticket, when you have that deadline, when you make it public, then it becomes an actuality.
Well,
I
think for me, you know, I actually started owning the procrastination element of it and being okay with that in my own skin. It was procrastinating and then not delivering to the deadline, right?
So that's the key.
That's the key.
That's a distinction. Right.
But I will get it done by the deadline.
So for my team, they know. They know I do a keynote, you know, hours before I have the presentations due. But instead of me feeling bad about that, it was like, hey, that's how I work. I just know that I need to know that deadline. Like I put it in the comments earlier. What I've started doing was the to-do list got me overwhelmed because everything is something due. And I started, I used to say, now what it says, I says what success looks like at the end of the day. And I have the task that must be completed today.
Yeah.
Everything else in between, I don't care how I get them done, which allows me to be a little bit, you know, jump on a blab or be a little bit more of a space cadet when I want to. And
right.
Know that I'm gonna hit my success metrics at the end of the day, and that's when I, you know, will stop working. Because you're right, I'm the same exact way. If someone gives, and I think prioritizing based on when it's due rather than what it is something that I also have become a little bit better at to, you know, stop the procrastination side.
Right, and then it takes the chatter out of your head of that guilt, like you're both just saying, of like, oh, who thinks I'm not doing it the way that I see somebody else do it? F that. What works for you?
And that's the funny thing is, like, you know, I know what has to be done. I use Wunderlist. I have my list. Okay,
yes.
This has to be done at the end of the day.
Write
that's
that
fine.
Down,
but, you know, guys. What's so funny is that you look at me, if you came in right now and looked at my Chrome tabs, and I'm just going to share this with you because it's freaking hysterical. So from left to right, PayPal, calendar, email. Okay, that's a given. Then a Google term, men's full waxing. Okay. Then for whatever reason, another calendar page. Then Google Drive. Then Google News, then dropzone.com for skydiving, TweetDeck, 3 Twitter pages of people I found interesting this morning, this blab, Dynamite Circle, a membership site I belong to, Wunderlist, 2 blank tabs in a row for whatever reason.
You're describing my brain, except for the full body waxing.
Working, building on Rainmaker. Vimeo, for whatever reason, seems to be up. My email mailing list software, Instagram, Slack. I don't even know what this one is. Someone I interviewed this morning for a podcast. Googling First Form, which is apparently BCAA, branched chain amino acids for working out. And then finally PayPal. So it's like, you'd think that I was schizophrenic, but the fact of the matter is that this works for me and it's not it works for me, right? It works in the form that I want it
right.
to. And so, you know, as long as that's the case, whatever that is, do that.
Couple things real quick. One, Peter, ask Megan if you're okay on time, because we are.
I just actually did. She said I have 8 minutes left.
Okay, awesome. So make it quick, everybody. A couple questions, and then I do, yeah, let's bring Frank in real quick. And then this is a good question. I know you talked about Concerta. Mine would be called Disconcerta. Meds versus natural supplements for management. And for me, fans want that one too, sweetheart.
So yeah, Fanzo, you could go for this. For me, a natural supplement is skydiving or running or speaking or something that increases my dopamine and serotonin naturally. I'm not a huge fan of supplements. I take a multivitamin. But yeah, for me, it's really about doing as much as possible in the natural world to pump up my dopamine, serotonin, and adrenaline than taking meds for it.
Yeah, I try to identify what that near time focus is. So I'm on Adderall, and I'm prescribed it, you know, twice a day. I don't do the delayed release; it's the twice a day. And so for me, I'm kind of the same way. I look at things and say, you know, what am I doing? What needs to be accomplished? And what's the element of my, you know, I'm passionate about everything, but what am I excited about? And I think when I'm excited, going on stage,
God, that's perfect.
And that's kind of where I work. As soon as I realize, hey, this is what I'm excited about doing, I know that I will accomplish it.
And then of course.
Oh man, I have 2 blog posts to write for that. Like, I know that that's not going to get accomplished. And I think also this is something I talked about last night on my Periscope, was actually also identifying how I like to create, not where, but how, because I love the talk. I love the video blog, but I've learned now, like, the amount of time I spend doing regular blogs, it takes too much time. And the reason I'm not excited about it is because I second guess myself. I get distracted by grammar. All of a sudden, you know, I use very similar apps on eliminating other distractors, but I actually get distracted in my own focus on, like, second guessing and those kind of things. Now I actually, you know, dictate everything, have someone else put it back into a script, and then I finalize. And owning that, holy crap, has that allowed me to be more excited about some of these finite tasks that I used to dread as something as simple as a blog. So I do medicate, but like I said, drug holidays have been my secret, because on the weekends when I don't medicate, it also allows me to understand the differences as well as the side effects. Like, I have the world's worst lockjaw whenever I have, when I'm on my Adderall. Like, I mean, it sounds like, I mean, it feels like someone's grinding.
It's Coke jaw.
That's like,
I've heard it. Someone else described it as Coke jaw. And it's funny because you see certain tics, and it's like, I've met people and I'm like, I know it's 9:30 in the morning. I know they're not on Coke, but I bet they're on Adderall or Concerta, and you just sort of, because they're smiling a lot. I think you have the thing where they're going to get,
I lick my lips too, because I get caught in my mouth.
Right. What was it?
Night on a Friday at the club. Oh my God.
I see it. Totally. What was it? We were at South by Fanzo, and it was so cute because I think you had forgotten. And I was like, here you go, baby. And I had that monster in my bag.
Oh, that was so great. Because I had no meds at South by, and I had no monster, which is
my second.
I had the 5-hour energy, and it was just, we literally looked like a little drug. I was just like, here you go, honey.
She gave me.
I want to throw this out there really fast, because this is something else that's important. You know, whether it's ADHD or not, I cannot stress enough how important it is to make sure that you're taking care of self-care. The concept of putting your own oxygen mask on before helping others has to apply to us as entrepreneurs and as people in working, because if we're not taking care of ourselves, we're not gonna be able to do anywhere near as good a shit as we like to. Mm-hmm. And we're no use to anyone if we're not doing our best. So I cannot encourage enough to make sure that we are taking care of ourselves and talking to someone, even if we have to. My God, I mean, I'm in New York City and I'm a Jew, so I have a therapist because it's required by law. But
except in August.
there are so many, you know, there's absolutely nothing wrong with therapy. It is not, there's no,
whatever it is you need to do.
Downside to it. I mean, even if you just, hell, talk to your masseuse, talk to whoever the hell you're talking to, but talk to someone, because let me tell you something. I've lost a few people to suicide in the past 15 years, entrepreneurs, just because they were too fucking stubborn to talk to someone. That's bullshit.
Totally.
Okay, because I have no idea what kind of amazing shit they would have produced if they stayed alive. So fuck that. If get help if you need to talk to shit, email me.
Yeah.
For Christ's sake.
Or any of us.
Someone out there.
I've lost a lot of people to suicide also.
It's a lonely road.
It is.
It's a lonely road.
And here's, I think, the other distinction, you guys, too, is that because our brains work faster, it's also louder. So when there is things that are disruptive, it's loud as F, right? And so if you can, that's the other sort of good thing, bad thing about it, too. So, hey, Frank Clark, welcome to the show, too.
Hey, thanks for sticking with me as I retried, because I probably have too many tabs open, so my lab wouldn't let me.
Pulling the Peter. You had some really great comments, too, guys. So we're going to wrap it up because Peter has about 6 minutes, but does anybody else have any good hack tips? Peter, do you want to give us some more? And then Frank, some comments.
I'm gonna keep it tight. I posted these 5-HT.
Yes.
I saw that.
L-tyrosine. These are both recommended by Dr. Daniel Amen. I highly recommend his books or watch his PBS specials. He's an expert on ADHD. He's a dual board certified, psychiatrist and neurologist. Brilliant man and great tips. So it comes back to know thyself. There's so many, so many strengths that it brings having ADHD. So you got to know the strengths and Peter was saying, establish great disciplines, great habits, read, learn about it and figure out how do you structure your day, how to come up with strategies so that you're doing the right things.
I want to answer Steve's question. That's a phenomenal point as well. What you said, Frank, but I want to answer Steve's question because he talks about, talks about deadlines. What about when you really need to be held accountable? So I'm not here trying to pitch my own shit, but one of the reasons I started my mastermind group, Shank Minds, is because it's an accountability group. So we have 2 phone calls a week for an hour apiece where basically we get on a video call and anyone who wants to ask questions, get help, whatever. But one of the things we do in order to get access to those video calls, we have a channel in our group on the forum called By Next Week I Will.
Ooh.
And you actually have to post what you're trying to get done by next week. And then we read it off on the call. So you want accountability, dude? You can't, if you're on that call and you haven't done it, we will hold your feet to the fire. So we have calls on Monday and Friday. So if it's a Thursday and you post it on Monday, okay, I have this to do by Friday. And it's a Thursday and you have a call in 12 hours and you haven't done it yet. We're going to hold you to that.
Right.
So the best accountability in the world is, it could be my mastermind group at shankminds.com or it could be any mastermind group or, create a group of your own friends, but make sure that there's an accountability function where they're holding you to that. Because, even for me, I'm in the process of rebuilding the site. And so I post in my own group, guys, by next week, I want to have the forums done. Make sure I do, and they'll hold me to it.
Right.
And sure enough, I have a call at 7 p.m. tonight and I got the forums done this morning. So it's probably one of the most beneficial things is just have a group of people, whether it's mastermind or whether it's a community or whatever, have a group of people who are willing to hold your feet to the fire and not, more importantly, not accept your bullshit as to reasons why you can't. My trainer has told me that if I miss more than one session a month without cause, like if I'm on the road, fine, we can reschedule as long as I tell her in advance. If I miss more than one session without cause, she won't be my trainer anymore.
Ooh, that's threatening. Because she's badass.
Give up. Right. She's willing to give me up as a client because she knows she'll get more if I'm not serious about it. And let me tell you something. Get my ass out of bed and I get there.
So I think, the accountability, the not glorifying busy, which I love that phrase too, guys, right? Yeah.
Oh yeah,
that's the other thing. Yeah, my I have people in my life. I won't mention who are constant. Oh my god, I'm so slammed. Oh my god, I'm so busy. I'm like, you fucking work smarter for fuck's sake. Jesus Christ.
Yeah, no kidding.
That's an FMS. Badge of honor,
you dumb shit.
It's funny. Something you said there, Peter. That I actually gave my team when I was building up my last team, I gave them full access into my Find My iPhone app, and they could all find my iPhone because it was accountability for me to not only not use the excuse of like, oh, I can't do that, I'm stuck in the airport, and they could look it up like, no, you're not, you're sitting in the office, like, or shut up, like, and it was a little bit of that. And then I also like Slack for that reason because I actually create, there's a group, it's my accountability side where when I post and add my tasks there, everything lives in Slack, so you'll even see it as it's striked or as it's removed or archived, and it's the job of my team to be like, wait, why did you archive that new website you were going to work on? It's because for me it was like, well, I just decided I wasn't going to get it done. So I love the idea of Shank Minds. I just went on the site. I might have to take you up on that, Peter.
So you'll be thrilled to know that we use Slack. Shank Minds on Slack. We're moving over to the web, but the Slack group will always be there.
Nice.
All right, before we wrap up, guys, we have 2 minutes. Best tips before we go, and then Peter, I know you got a jet, brother. So, fans, what are some of your favorites, and then we'll finish up, and then Frank, if you want to jump in too.
I think for me the best tip is defining what works for you and living and being okay with that. The only person that I have to prove value for on what is the best way that I learn is the person that looks back at me in the mirror. And as long as I realize that, because for so long I read everybody else's tips to a clean office, to when I work best, all of these things. And then when I started identifying when the hell I did all of these things best, my life became easier, my work became more productive, and I became happier. So I think for me, it's about pleasing that person in the mirror. And I actually write my goals with a Expo marker on my mirror because it helps me remember as well that that's the person that wrote them and that's the person that is held accountable. So that's my last tip. I love it though, Peter. I love the site, love the whole mission. So
it's awesome. I think, and I'm going to segue to Peter and then Frank, if you'll put yours in the comments here, is it be okay with being messy? Because if it looks messy, but it works for you, doesn't matter. Brother Peter, closing thoughts.
That works, definitely. That doesn't work for me. I gotta have some sort of, semblance of order, but yeah. I totally get it. So my thing is a couple of quotes. So I heard a great quote the other day. I've actually heard it for years, but I was reminded of it the other day, and it's definitely one of my top five. It's simply not my circus, not my monkeys, right? It's another way of saying we can control what we can control. And the day that you learn to let go of the shit you can't control, there's a Buddhist quote, let go or be dragged, right?
I
once I realize that I can change myself, I am constantly on a path to make myself better. And it's not my job to change other people's lives. If they want to change or, you know, to make other people change to conform to me, I have to conform to what I need to be.
Yeah.
I'd say also in along with that, you know, yes, you want to do your own thing and you want to not care what other people do, what other people think of you. And sometimes it's sort of hard to do that. So a friend of mine who's a skydiver, an older skydiver, when I first started jumping back in 2005, he told me this. And you want to listen to older skydivers because that means they've been jumping for years and they haven't killed themselves. So they obviously know their shit. And so the best quote I was ever given in my life, 100%, was by this guy. I was bitching about the fact that my friends who don't skydive don't understand why I do. My friends who do skydive don't understand why I wouldn't want to do it all the time. And this old guy, long beard, out of the, you know, just looks at me and says, son, if you can't change the people around you, change the people around you.
Exactly.
And so that was incredible. Do your own thing, man. Do your own thing. And at the end of the day, if you've been able to make life better for someone, you know, and you've helped someone else, maybe made the universe a little better, and with any luck, helped an animal as well, then, you know, you're okay in my book.
I love you so much, seriously. Oh, you had to put the animal thing in there, didn't you? I love it. Guys, go
back to the normal.com and then shankminds.com. Thank you, Mia. As always, I love you. I'll do anything for you.
Love you, darling. Yay.
With you. Thanks.
Bye. Bye, guys. Bye. Thanks. All right, guys. We are out of here. Peter's out of here. Brian had to go. Frank, thanks for jumping on. Robsy, great to see you. Hey, you guys, I was really actually just trying to stay focused on this, so I wasn't answering as many questions because I was focusing on that. So thank you for joining us. Go on and subscribe at miaonthego.com. You can follow all my adventures and my interviews. So bye, guys. Thank you. That was so fun. Yay. Bye. Bye.